you please be seated? A very warm welcome to your annual carol service here at St. Botolph's with Bishopsgate this Christmas. Today we gather together as a company to enjoy in music and words the Christmas story of the birth of Jesus Christ our Lord. We also remember today Andrew Beazley. It was so typical of Andrew to choose carols to be sung at his memorial service, and we carry forward that tradition today as we cherish his memory. Christmas and the run-up to Christmas is traditionally a time of hope and optimism, a time when even the most pessimistic person can see and believe there is some good in the world. Some religious and spiritual people talk about thin places. These are places where you get a true sense of the nearness of heaven, an almost fearful sense of its perhaps imminent breaking through. That is what happens around the world at Christmas, the sense of perhaps the imminent breaking through of heaven. And that is the greatest hope we can have for our world today. From all at St. Botolph's with Bishopsgate, may I take this opportunity to wish you all a very happy Christmas when it comes, and best wishes for a happy, peaceful, and prosperous new year. Let us pray. Beloved in Christ, be it this Christmastide our care and delight, to hear again the message of the angels, and in heart and mind to go even unto Bethlehem, and see this thing which has come to pass, and the babe lying in a manger. Therefore, let us read and mark in Holy Scripture the tale of the loving purposes of God from the first days of our disobedience unto the glorious redemption brought us by this holy child. But first, let us pray for the needs of the whole world, for peace on earth, goodwill among all his people, for unity, sisterhood and brotherhood within the church he came to build, and especially in this great city of London. And because this of all things would rejoice us heart, let us pray and remember in his name the poor and helpless, the cold, the hungry and the oppressed, the sick and them that mourn, the lonely and the unloved, the aged and the little children. And lastly, let us remember before God all those who rejoice with us, but upon another shore and in a greater light, that multitude which no one can number, whose hope was in the Word made flesh, and with whom, in the Lord Jesus, we are forever one. These prayers and praises let us humbly offer up to the throne of heaven in the words which Christ himself hath taught us. Our Father, who art in heaven, hallowed be thy name. Thy kingdom come, thy will be done, on earth as it is in heaven. Give us this day our daily bread, and forgive us our trespasses, as we forgive those who trespass against us. And lead us not into temptation, but deliver us from evil. For thine is the kingdom, the power, and the glory, for ever and ever. Amen.
Christ's birth and kingdom are foretold by Isaiah. The people walking in darkness have seen a great light. On those living in the land of deep darkness, a light has dawned. For to us a child is born, to us a son is given, and the government will be on his shoulders. And he will be called Wonderful Counselor, Mighty God, Everlasting Father, Prince of Peace. Of the greatness of his government and peace, there will be no end. He will reign on David's throne and over his kingdom, establishing and upholding it with justice and righteousness from that time on and forever. The zeal of the Lord Almighty will accomplish this. Thanks be to God. The angel Gabriel salutes the Blessed Virgin Mary. In the sixth month, God sent the angel Gabriel to Nazareth, a town in Galilee, to a virgin pledged to be married to a man named Joseph, a descendant of David. The virgin's name was Mary. The angel went to her and said, "Greetings, you who are highly favored. The Lord is with you." Mary was greatly troubled at his words and wondered what kind of greeting this might be. But the angel said to her, "Do not be afraid, Mary. You have found favor with God. You will conceive and give birth to a son, and you are to call him Jesus. He will be great and will be called the Son of the Most High. The Lord God will give him the throne of his father David, and he will reign over Jacob's descendants forever. His kingdom will never end." "How shall this be?" Mary asked the angel, "since I am a virgin." The angel answered, "The Holy Spirit will come on you, and the power of the Most High will overshadow you. So the Holy One to be born will be called the Son of God." Thanks be to God. Thank you.
St. Luke tells of the birth of Jesus. In those days, Caesar Augustus issued a decree that a census should be taken of the entire Roman world. This was the first census that took place while Quirinius was governor of Syria. And everyone went to their own town to register. So Joseph also went up from the town of Nazareth in Galilee to Judea, to Bethlehem, the town of David, because he belonged to the house and line of David. He went there to register with Mary, who was pledged to be married to him and was expecting a child. While they were there, the time came for the baby to be born, and she gave birth to her firstborn, a son. She wrapped him in cloths and placed him in a manger, because there was no guest room available for them. And there were shepherds living out in the fields nearby, keeping watch over their flocks at night. An angel of the Lord appeared to them, and the glory of the Lord shone about them, and they were terrified. But the angel said to them, "Do not be afraid. I bring you good news that will cause great joy for all people. Today, in the town of David, a Savior has been born to you. He is the Messiah, the Lord. This will be a sign to you. You will find a baby wrapped in cloths and lying in a manger." Suddenly, a great company of the heavenly host appeared with the angel, praising God and saying, "Glory to God in the highest heaven, and on earth peace to those on whom his favor rests." When the angel had left them and gone into heaven, the shepherds said to one another, "Let's go to Bethlehem and see this thing that has happened, which the Lord has told us about." So they hurried off and found Mary and Joseph, and the baby who was lying in the manger. When they had seen him, they spread the word concerning what they had been told about this child, and all who heard it were amazed at what the shepherds said to them. But Mary treasured up these things and pondered them in her heart. The shepherds returned, glorifying and praising God for all the things they had heard and seen, which were just as they had been told. Thanks be to God.
Still, still, still. The wise men are led by the star to Jesus. After Jesus was born in Bethlehem in Judea during the time of King Herod, Magi from the east came to Jerusalem and asked, "Where is the one who has been born King of the Jews? We saw his star when it rose and have come to worship him." When King Herod heard this, he was disturbed, and all Jerusalem with him. When he had called together all the people's chief priests and teachers of the law, he asked them where the Messiah was to be born. "In Bethlehem in Judea," they replied, "for this is what the prophet has written. But you, Bethlehem, in the land of Judah, are by no means last among the rulers of Judah, for out of you will come a ruler who will shepherd my people Israel." Then Herod called the Magi secretly and found out from them the exact time the star had appeared. He sent them to Bethlehem and said, "Go and search carefully for the child. As soon as you find him, report to me, so that I too may go and worship him." After they had heard the king, they went on their way, and the star they had seen when it rose went ahead of them, until it stopped over the place where the child was. When they saw the star, they were overjoyed. On coming to the house, they saw the child with his mother Mary, and they bowed down and worshipped him. Then they opened their treasures and presented him with gifts of gold, frankincense, and myrrh. And having been warned in a dream not to go back to Herod, they returned to their country by another route. Thanks be to God.
John unfolds the great mystery of the Incarnation. In the beginning was the Word, and the Word was God, and the Word was God. He was with God in the beginning. Through him all things were made. Without him nothing was made that has been made. In him was life, and that life was the light of all mankind. The light shines in the darkness, and the darkness has not overcome it. There was a man sent from God whose name was John. He came as a witness to testify concerning that light, so that through him all might believe. He himself was not the light. He came only as a witness to the light. The true light that gives light to everyone was coming into the world. He was in the world, and though the world was made through him, the world did not recognize him. He came to that which was his own, but his own did not receive him. Yet to all who did receive him, to those who believed in his name, he gave the right to become children of God, children born not of natural descent, nor of human decision or a husband's will, but born of God. The Word became flesh and made his dwelling among us. We have seen his glory, the glory of the one and only Son, who came from the Father, full of grace and truth. Thanks be to God.
Again, a warm welcome to St. Botolph's today. As I said in my welcome earlier, Christmas of all times of the year must be the season of hope. The season not just to keep hope alive, but to encourage hope, to let hope flourish, to let it dictate how we live our lives and how we interact with others. When we use the word hope in casual conversation, it often has a wavering, uncertain sound. I hope I can make it, we say doubtfully. But faith uses hope in a completely different way. In faith, hope focuses on optimism and eager expectation. No one who learns to hope in faith will be overcome by disappointment, but will be filled with patience, encouragement, and enthusiasm. We live in hope, yet the fulfillment of hope lies in the future. When we have hope, we have the courage to face each day and every situation. And we see in the future possibilities and opportunities. In the most basic way, hope is a relational term. It is a great affirmation of trust, perhaps in God, not because we know what lies ahead, but because our hope gives us strength and understanding that we will always be able to cope with no matter what is coming. In times of crisis, hope can be a beacon of light in the darkness. It can give us the strength and courage to keep going, to keep fighting, and to keep believing in a better future. Whether we are facing personal challenges or global crises, hope is a powerful force that can make us overcome adversity and create a more positive and just world for ourselves and for others. In the midst of gloom and despair, we can sow even the smallest seed of hope. If we can, then we have done some good in our lives. Hope springs eternal, and those of us who are gardeners will recognize that truism in cultivation, in springtime preparation and sowing. A seed in itself is a hope-filled object. It is a small, inconsequential thing, yet a thing of mystery. When a seed is sown, the sower cannot fully know what is to come. Each seed is unique. Some will grow into strong and healthy plants, even trees. However, some seeds may never germinate and simply become lost in the earth. Just as the one who sows does not know which seed will flourish, we too do not know what might become of the seeds of hope we attempt to sow in our everyday lives. We do not know the impact of some word of kindness, some sign of compassion. We do not know what seeds these acts sow in the hearts of those around us. In the readings and words of carols and in prayers around Christmastide, there are frequent references to lightness and dark. Those who sit in darkness have seen a great light coming out of the darkness of despair into the light of hope. We have all experienced a turbulent year. We have violence and savagery continuing in the Middle East. We are still observing the ravages brought about by unprovoked invasion and war on the edge of Europe. We have ongoing wars in Ethiopia, Sudan, Yemen. We have humanitarian catastrophes throughout the world. We have deepening political crises and division everywhere, in the Netherlands and elsewhere in Europe, in the United States, South America, India, and other countries throughout the world where divisively polemic politics are becoming, sadly, the new norm. The need for a time of hope could not be more apparent. We need to hope. I pray that this Christmas, we, in whatever way, large or small we can, we give the gift of hope to all those we encounter, and we encourage that hope to grow and flourish, bringing much needed light to all who still sit in darkness. Let us pray. Father, your Son, our Saviour, was born in human flesh. Renew your church in the body of Christ. There was no room for your Son in the inn. Protect with your love those who have no home and all who live in poverty. Mary, in the pain of labor, brought your Son to birth. Hold in your hand all those who are in pain or distress. Lord, your Christ came as a light shining in the darkness. Bring comfort to all who suffer in the sadness of our world. Lord, the angels sang peace to God's people on earth. Strengthen those who work for peace and justice in all the world. Shepherds in the field heard good tidings. Give us grace to preach the gospel of Christ's redemption.
Oh.
Lord, strangers found the Holy Family and saw the baby lying in the manger. Bless our homes and all whom we love. Heaven is come down to earth, and earth is raised to heaven. Hold in your hand all those who have passed through death in the hope of your coming kingdom. Lord, your followers throughout the world celebrate Christ's birth. Open our hearts that he may be born in us today. Amen. May the joy of the angels, the eagerness of the shepherds, the perseverance of the wise men, the obedience of Joseph and Mary, and the peace of the Christ child be yours this Christmas. And the blessing of God Almighty, the Father, the Son, and the Holy Spirit be among you and remain with you always. Amen.